Hello, my fellow gearheads, Milan Reindl over here, and according to your countless wishes, I'm bringing you another video that should potentially help you get better at building with LEGO Technic elements and help you develop building functions. Today, we're gonna be looking at levers, or levers if you prefer the American English pronunciation, and linkages. Let's start the video with the basic terminology. A lever or a lever is a beam that has one point of support, which is called the fulcrum, around which it can rotate. It can be balanced like this one, which is like a kid's seesaw at the playground, or one of the sides of the lever can be longer than the other. And afterwards, the forces that need to be applied to balance out both the sides differ depending on the length of the arms. The longer the arm and the further out you go from the center, the lower the forces need to be to counterbalance the same amount of force on the other side. You can as well move the fulcrum all the way to the end, and you create a single-sided lever or lever, which is pretty much a door handle. Other examples of basic levers include scissors, pliers, wrenches, other types of tools, water pumps, and you name it, you can find it pretty much everywhere around you. If you connect several arms together, you create something that is called a linkage, which is the basic principle of the mechanisms I'm gonna show you today. If you have both the arms on the opposite sides of the same length, you create something that is called a parallel linkage. So if I move the blue beam, the green beam rotates at the same speed and at the same angle, which is pretty much, if you have two gear wheels of the same size, it's exactly the same. If we afterwards move the pivot points to make the arms of different lengths, you create something that is called a non-parallel linkage, which is the same as if you use gear wheels of different sizes next to each other. So you can see that the blue one rotates a lot more than the green one, and the green one moves a little bit less than the blue one. There of course might be afterwards the case, depending on which arm you use as the input and the output, that the linkage might block itself, which sometimes you don't want to do that. So yeah, parallel linkage, same arms opposite of each other, non-parallel, at least one of them has different length than the other ones. And all of these types of linkages have different usage in real life. Depending as well where you attach the arms together, you might get a slightly different results in rotation and slightly different results in angles, but this is still a parallel linkage because both the arms have the same length on the opposite sides. So yeah, you can use this, for example, on any construction machinery that lifts the load and needs to afterwards tilt it. It depends just where you attach this section and where you put the tool afterwards over here. Pretty much the same works over here, but just see what do the ends of these angular beams create if you have them attached in parallel linkage, but these arms are suddenly rotating at a slightly different angle, and you can get a lot different movement afterwards at the end. If you are not expert in Technic, you might have seen something similar in many of the spacewalkers that were designed in the 80s and 90s, which is again a parallel linkage that uses the simple 2x2 turntables from the system platform, and then you just connect it by the plates and you can have afterwards things moving back and forth. And another great example where we very often in LEGO Technic use the parallel linkage is the simple steering of a vehicle. So you can see that the wheels go at the same angle, at the same speed from side to side. Another great example of parallel linkage that was used in the Middle Ages, especially for copying manuscripts and drawings, was the pantograph, which is pretty much a mechanical copy machine. I don't think I need to show you how to build this one, because you just need four beams and few pins to connect this together. But the principle is actually very simple. If you wanted to draw something in bigger scale, you just held your hand over here and moved it over the picture, and afterwards placed a pen in here, and the pen was drawing enlarged picture or writing of the stuff that you moved your pen over. If you wanted to shrink something, you just did the opposite. You just used the longer arm, and afterwards the other one was doing exactly the opposite. So it was drawing the stuff on a smaller scale. Similar principle afterwards is used in a non-parallel linkage, where you just move the pivot points on the pantograph a little bit closer towards the corner. And by using linkage like this, you might get a lot more travel from the movement of the linkage. In this case, it's close to 270 degrees. And you can see that just by pushing on the gray beam, I can get a lot of movement. Linkages like this are very often used on crane trucks, on the foldable crane arms. Again, I'm gonna show you the close-up in case you would like to copy something like this. Then I can very briefly as well show you the self-locking linkages. The simpler of them doesn't look like much, but it's very often used on, let's say, the forks of a forklift. If you tilt them forwards, they are fully tilted at an angle and it can't go anywhere else. Afterwards, the gravity does the job over here for you, and if it overcomes this point, you can't pull on this section, so they stay afterwards fully folded in. So the principle is simply just to have a defined positions and afterwards something that can move in and out. But most importantly, I would like to show you this self-locking linkage. You might have seen it previously on many other LEGO Technic planes and helicopters, because that's what we very often use for the landing gears. If I move this arm, you can see that it doesn't go anywhere because it's already locked in position. And the trick over here is that you have this section consisting of two arms that can independently rotate, and it afterwards creates a little bend. So as soon as we move the yellow one, it doesn't go anywhere. And if you want to fold the landing legs with the landing gear back to the fuselage of the plane, you just rotate it like this and it goes totally flush. Just imagine there would be the wheel of the plane or of the aircraft that you would be deploying from the fuselage. To build it, you don't need much. You need a big L-beam, 3x5. Then in this middle hole of the foot, you place a beam of your desired length. And in here, at the end of the L-beam, you place the smaller 2x4 L-beam in whatever color you want. Here you need to place a pin with a ball, or a regular pin would do as well. And in here, just above this corner point of the lift arm, you put, or the L-beam, sorry, you put two 4-module lift arms, and voila, that's it. So afterwards, when you again hit any obstacle with the wheels, they do not collapse on their own. The landing gear is locked thanks to gravity and thanks to overcoming this pivot point, so it creates kind of bend. And again, simply by applying a little bit of force and having friction in these two pins, it holds the landing gear perfectly in the fuselage of the plane or helicopter. Another type of a self-locking linkage is very often used for simple outriggers at LEGO Technic. You can see that this arm sits almost parallel to this, which would be the body, let's say, of a crane truck or anything that deploys stabilizers. And the trick over here is that you have this arm shorter than this one over here, and then you have a stopper on which this small beam leans, and then when you afterwards apply pressure from the bottom, it doesn't go anywhere, it doesn't collapse back into the body of the crane. Again, to build it, nothing too difficult. You just need a few beams. This is the placement of the connectors over here, and then you just connect it into this linkage. That way it stays parallel with the body, that way it deploys out of the body and stays stuck in the deployed position. Sometimes in the functions we need to translate rotary movement or simple rotation into something that moves back and forth, and we could afterwards just define the stoppers for the function so it just goes one way and then needs to return, or it could be continuous as in this case. A similar principle is often used as well on steam locomotives with the push rods that are going in the steam pistons. Nothing super fancy over here. You have two beams, one beam that slides in between, and afterwards two arms of different length, one of them shorter. So when it rotates, the yellow one still can rotate around it without hitting against it, and that way you can just have the function continuously rotating, transferring rotary movement into linear, which means in line. Another version of something similar would be like this, which is even closer to the steam locomotive that I mentioned as well. You can as well use gear wheels to be the inputs for the functions if you really want to, but it's not necessary. You can as well have regular wheels of a car or whatever. And the trick over here is that this connector slides back and forth on a cross axle while this gear wheel rotates. If you would like to create oscillating movement in the function, you just need one of the arms to be very much shorter than the other one, and then you can see what it does. If you rotate the crankshaft, this one moves back and forth just a little while this is making full revolutions. Again, to build something like this, you don't need much. It's just one very short arm that rotates and one slightly longer beam and something to connect the two sides with, and that way you can create oscillating function. Other cool example of a very nice linkage that transfers rotary movement into linear is Poselier cell, which is named after a French officer in the army, which invented this mechanism in the, I believe, 19th century. And I learned about it from Sariel's book on LEGO Technic, so I totally recommend his unofficial guide to LEGO Technic if you want to see and explore more of this stuff. But the basic principle of this is that you have a parallelogram or parallel linkage, which has the same length of the arms, therefore I have them in the green. Then you have another length of the arm that attaches to this whole section, and then two arms of the same length. And this was the first device actually that could draw perfectly straight lines by transferring rotary movement to linear. So when you rotate the whole thing, the red dot that I have over here stays in line, as you can see, which is super cool in my opinion. Yeah, and I can give you the full movement of this. And as I said, the red dot should stay pretty much in a straight line. Of course, there are some tolerances in the LEGO parts and a little bit of wiggle, but still, it's quite fascinating to look at. If you need a mechanism afterwards that can translate linear movement to rotary and rotary to linear, regardless of what you use as input and output, this is, again, a quite fascinating thing to build. What you need is simply a beam that is trapped in between two other beams, so it can slide back and forth. And if I move the red lever, you can see that it rotates, but this gray beam just moves back and forth, so I am transferring the rotary movement to linear. Good enough. This thing as well works both ways, so if I just shift this beam back and forth, you can see that it's sliding, so I'm transferring linear movement to a rotation of the red arm at the end of this linkage. And again, to build it, you don't need much. Again, two beams, something to be trapped in between, and afterwards feel free to experiment with different lengths of these two colorful arms. The other type of linkage that is crucial to making organic movement and walk is Hoken's linkage, and it's a linkage that translates rotary movement to somewhat linear movement. The trick is that, you know, you, when you walk, need to be able to raise your leg, put it down, shift afterwards your weight forwards, and then raise the leg again so you can make a step and move from point A to point B. So if you've seen any LEGO Technic walkers, they are using very similar principle. For example, my walking horse or any other 6, 2, 4, 8 legged walkers that you have seen out there. The other use of this linkage is actually for making moving and flapping wings, because by just moving the arm like this and rotating, I can move two section wing without any problems, like so. And afterwards you can create some nice organic movements. Again, if you want to take a look into some LEGO sets, I recommend the Harry Potter Hedwig, and afterwards the Phoenix and the Hungarian Thorntail Dragon, because they used very similar principle. Just to demonstrate the Hoken linkage's use for flapping the wings, this is the Blue Dragon that I built from the McLaren Senna 42123 1.5 years ago, and the instructions are available for purchase on my Rebrickable. And this is the effect that you get if you afterwards have battery box that can adjust the speed of the rotation, because with directly 9 volts connected to the motor, it would be flapping at ridiculous speeds and maybe even damaging the gear wheels. So I suggest getting something like this or gearing it down before you motorize it. Another great example in achieving fluid and organic moving functions is using a crankshaft. You can see that all these arms are of different color, but it's just to emphasize that they do a slightly different sequence of movement. The ones that are closest to the center move a lot more than the ones that are closer to the sides. And again, you don't need much to build this. These are the small parts that you use in every combustion engine in LEGO Technic models. And the only issue with this type of mechanism is that, you know, the crankshaft is pretty wobbly, so I wouldn't put too much load on any of these arms. But other than that, you can get 4 different movements just building something like this. The other thing that could be interesting to use is the classic Technic cam, and you can use it with either elastic band over here, which pulls it back all the time, or you can just use gravity if you don't have the elastic bands. And you can see that how I rotate this X-shaped mechanism, this fluently raises up and afterwards quickly drops down. So this could be as well very interesting for usage in any Technic model to create oscillating movement of something that goes back and forth and always returns to its original position. If you would like to synchronize movement of two arms without using any gear wheels, it's actually fairly simple. The most basic one is building a scissor linkage that you can use afterwards as a grabber to pick up some things for you, or just to extend sections of the models. What you need is the beams of the same length, and afterwards you connect them in the middle and at the end, and just repeat. The only disadvantage of this linkage, which is used again in many toys like the gun with the boxing glove at the end and etc., is that it's pretty wobbly, and very often and very quickly it starts to bend. But it's nice and simple and a lot of fun. Another mechanism that you can use for synchronized movement of the arms is this type of grabber, where you have one beam that slides back and forth and is connected via simple linkage to these two arms. So you need a T-beam underneath, 2 3-module beams, and then two module beams, one with the cross hole at the end, so it can rotate back and forth. And obviously you don't need to build this from Technic bricks, it can be as well built from regular beams, but this is the end result, and you can use it for cargo doors, doors on a train, bus, whatever, or again simply again as a grabber that picks up something and drops it afterwards off at a different destination. Last but not least, we have a mechanism that has been as well successfully used previously in deploying some things outwards from a body of a truck, or it could be as well, you know, gun turrets on sides of Star Wars tank, whatever. Again, uses transfer of rotary movement into linear that gets synchronized. So you start building an arm that rotates in the middle around this pivot point, simply using the two module beam with a cross to give you a cross hole in the middle. And afterwards you connect two other beams of the same length to other sections that can slide back and forth in between other beams. And this way these can immediately deploy at the same speed, to the same distance at the same time. And you just activate it by rotating this cross axle. And lastly, you can as well use shock absorbers or the regular shock coils from the Technic vehicles to activate some functions using levers and linkages. And these are just some examples. Feel free to experiment as well with the parts that you have at home. But for example, this one stays at this position. If you flick it, it moves more approximately 90 degrees. The advantage of this is that these things tend to stay at their position until you overcome the force that is in the shock absorber. Something like this was used to hold the doors open and closed on the 4269, the Extreme Adventure that I designed in 2017, so feel free to check that one out. Or I can just bring it over here actually and show it to you. The other type of a spring-loaded linkage is built like this. So you have an L-beam to which you attach another L-shaped beam, and then a three-module beam that lengthens this section to get the connection point for the shock. And this pretty much moves by 90 degrees. You can as well define the end position so this doesn't go below. And in this position it stays almost perfectly vertical. So you can see how the shock defines the two positions of this simple yet effective mechanism. Same goes for this one, an L-beam attached to a 5-module beam, and both of these get attached to L-beam. Both of them are two modules far from the corner. And that way you can get something that has quite a lot of resistance, but again rotates almost 90 degrees. And the last one I have over here is using an angular 3x7 module beam. And this is the full movement of this linkage. So it sits almost flat and then it rotates over 90 degrees, approximately 110 degrees. And again, all you need is an L-beam. At the corner you attach this one, and at the front of the shorter arm you attach the shock absorber, and then you link it to the second hole from the end on the angular beam. So here you have the 420-69, just to give you the example of the spring-loaded mechanism that opens and closes the door. And what controls the movement that you can see over here is nothing but a linkage of several beams that gets activated and pulled and pushed at the same time. So afterwards the door sits flush when it gets closed. And here is my old friend from the 90s again to demonstrate how frequently you have linkages used in the model. The rear axle steering is nothing but a linkage, and the same goes for lowering and lifting the front bucket, and again the same goes as well for tilting the bucket. So for lowering and lifting it uses a parallel linkage, for tilting it uses a non-parallel linkage. You can see that this arm is shorter than this one. So this is it from my side. I hope you had fun. Hope it's gonna be useful for you when you start incorporating levers and linkages into your model. Let me know as well in the comments if anything was unclear. And if you did enjoy watching the video, hit the like button. And if you are new over here, consider subscribing or watching any of the two videos that are suggested at the end. Until next time, everybody, stay safe, take care, and bye-bye.